Hey, good evening, everyone. Welcome to Business Cycle Masterclass. I am Niraj Gogoi, and I'll be the host for this exciting event. First of all, thank you. Thank you for investing your time on this Friday evening. I'm sure you all are excited. As you know, everything in the nature is cyclical. So are the economy, industries, and the market. So all are cyclical. Once you understand and develop the insight into these cycles, you have the trump card to create wealth through investment. So without spending much time, let's get into the real thing. Learn from the masters who have spent decades analyzing and investing through those business cycles, and they will help you develop your insight into those business cycles, guys. So before we start, let me read out the statutory disclaimer for the event. Investment in the securities market are subject to market risk. Read all the related documents carefully before investing. Representations are not indicative of future results. All the discussions are purely educational in nature and are in no way an advice or recommendations. Now, to make the whole learning process more interesting and fun-filled, we'll be having a quiz competition running over the next 2 days during the masterclass. So let me explain the rules for the competition first. We'll be posting questions throughout the sessions on both days, and all I have to do is answer them by selecting the right answer. The competition is split into 4 rounds. There will be separate winners for each round. For each round, you'll have 3 questions. The correct answer will get you a positive score of 10 points. And each day, we'll play 2 rounds. It means we'll play 2 rounds today and we'll play 2 rounds tomorrow. At the end of each round, we'll pick the top winners based on correct answers and the fastest finger first. Now, let me tell you what you are going to win if you become a winner. The round one will be having 5 lucky winners who will be winning insider stash worth rupees 400, which they can redeem on Paytm Insider against any future event they wish to attend. Round two, 5 lucky winners will get book recommended by our experts that will help you ace your trading and investing game. Round three, 3 lucky winners will get Puma, Ferrari, LS, Zenito backpack. That is black in color. Of course, there'll be 3 winners for that round three. That will be tomorrow. And round four will be having 3 lucky winners, and they will get personal access to our mentors' one-on-one sessions. So guys, and finally, we'll be having a grand prize that will be declared. And the grand prize will be, Galaxy Tab A7 Lite. And top 10 scorers across all the 4 rounds will be picked for the lucky draw. And we will unveil the winner live before the end of the session tomorrow, So guys, please keep attending, pay attention to each and every questions, all the discussions, so that you can give the right answers. And also, I'd like to tell you that we'll be sharing all the PPTs and the recordings within 10 working days of the completion of the session. The first session today will be a panel discussion. The topic will be introduction to business cycle. And let me introduce the panel members one by one. Our first panel member is Mr. Siddharth Damani. Mr. Siddharth Damani is the head of business enablement at Aditya Birla Sun Life AMC Limited. He has over 2 decades of experience and has been part of organization since October 1998. Siddharth holds a bachelor degree in commerce from Sydenham College of Commerce and Economics and master's degree in business administration from Queensland University of Technology, Brisbane, Australia. The second member of the panel discussion today is Mr. Anil Gilani, chartered financial analyst and fund manager for more than 18 years. He is the head of passive investments and products, DSP investment managers. Anil has been working with the DSP group since 2003. DSP group has a legacy of more than 150 years, making it one of the oldest and most respected financial service company in the country. He is currently head of passive investments and products. And guys, the last panel member, in fact, he is going to be the host for the panel discussion, and he is Mr. Raj Shamani. So let me introduce Raj. Raj is an entrepreneur, an investor who has featured in top 10 young entrepreneurs in India India's list of Asia Age. Being an active investor, he likes to share his knowledge and experience with people so that they can better manage their investment and learn about financial world. He has also featured in the top five young influencers in India, India's list of your story, and like to use his platform to educate people and on numerous topics. And also, I'd like to tell you that he is a great motivator and he is a great inspiration. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome all the panel members with a big round of applause. Welcome onto the stage, guys, our panel members. Yes, over to you, Raj. Welcome onto the stage, guys, and over to you, Raj.
Thank you so much for introducing all of us and having this amazing session. I'm really stoked to understand more about business cycles. Thank you to panelists to be here, Anil and Siddharth. I just hope that I try to do justice with everyone who's listening and do justice with you guys as well to ask you really good questions which can help each and everyone. Really looking forward to this. I want to start off by saying this. You know, I started my business journey when I was 16. So right out of the school, in my 12th, I wanted to start my business. And my dad used to tell me that, Raj, if you want to do business, find out something which is recession proof, which is which stands out in every business cycle. And I didn't know what that means. And at that time, all it makes sense to me was do FMCG, because as a naive young person, I was like, soaps to everyday people will use, right? So whether it's depression or a peak, people will use soaps. So I wanted to do that. And then I started media. So I've always heard about business cycles and always heard about those things. But when I started investing, you just can't go with one sector and enjoy and feel like this is it, that this is going to help you and safeguard you in every business cycle. That is why I was curious to know and have on this conversation with both of you experts right here. Do you mind if we start directly off the bat with the questions? Sure. All right. So first of all, let's just talk about what is business cycle for everyone who's listening. Can we explain that in the most simplest way? Over to you, Siddharth. Can you share it with people, what do you mean by business cycle?
Thanks, Raj, and thanks for getting and talking about this topic, which is very close to my heart. And as you said, you know, when I started my career, it was the same dilemma I had. So, you know, what I'm going to do is, try to narrate in terms of simply what business cycle means. So, you know, in a very simple language, Raj, you know, an economy goes through, you know, lots of ups and downs, we all know. And, business cycle typically is an economic cycle, to put it very, very simply. And this rise and fall in the economic growth is over time. So, you know, it's not limited to one time or other. It goes over time. So business cycle, Raj, you know, actually refers to the, as I said, economy-wide fluctuation. So, you know, what do we track? You know, that what are companies producing? How's the trade? And how's the typical, you know, general economic activity? You know, which, okay, you know, we all read and listen in various forums and media. So, you know, these fluctuations in economic activities are measured by something which we all hear about, GDP, gross domestic product. So, you know, just to share, you know, the changes in business cycle actually is a reflection of changes in the corporate profits, you know, what companies are making as profits. What is the credit availability in terms of, you know, what are the interest rates at that time? You know, how much products and services a company has been able to sell, or what is there in their inventory? Today we are talking about a lot of, there are no cars available for a simple reason, because there are no chips. So basically, yeah, you know, people want to buy, but there are no cars. So, you know, it's all sold out. And of course, the monetary policy and economic activity. So, actually, you know, what finally happens is the market and returns are largely driven by earnings, which we all go through and see, you know, which companies are and sectors are declaring their results. So when just to conclude, you know, when an economy is growing, you know, businesses are basically doing well. Companies are making profits. You know, the sentiments prevailing in the markets are typically more positive, bullish, and thus the market does well. But, you know, when the reverse happens in a business cycle, which, you know, when there's a downturn, you know, economic activities come down, businesses are suffering, and we see the markets also coming down, there's a fear factor in the market. You know, that again is a part of the business cycle, which I'm sure when we move forward, we are going to explain it much more at length.
All right. Look, I get it. Like most of the time it is, most of the people don't figure this out. We just look at one part of it. We just look at the earnings and what's going on. And based on that we take investment decisions, right? And there are different phases of the business cycle which are impacting our investments on an individual level. So Anil, why don't you tell everybody like what are the phases which Siddharth ended on? Like what do you feel? What are the phases of business cycle? What are the different phases? How can an individual make sense out of it?
Sure. I think first of all, friends, wish you all a very warm welcome. Good evening to everyone. It's great to have all of you here at this masterclass. Carrying on further from what we just spoke about, I think all the different so-called phases or elements of a business cycle are very much interconnected. It's like if you look at today's world, you know, we are so interconnected with everything. Broadly speaking, even in terms of the different phases of a cycle, we are very much interconnected. So how, when I say interconnected, what I mean by that is that at each space or each phase of your cycle, you know, broadly there can be four phases if you think of it. The first is, if you look at it, is the expansion phase, where there is a huge increase in the broader activity, like what we just discussed, you know, and then you will see a good increase in employment, you know, the demand and supply, both sides are very robust. Because of that, we are seeing good corporate profits or earnings as we very closely track. And that automatically, while that expansion phase is happening, it's building the foundation or the blocks for the next phase, which if we think of it, will be at some level come to the peak. Fair enough, once you are doing a good growth, there has to be a peak. And when you come to that peak, that is an inflection point, you start the next kind of area to look at it, where there is a broad level of, you know, limit which we feel now is attained. You know, so some of those broad economic indicators that we just spoke about, like the demand and supplies are robust, because of that the profits of companies are good, they reach some level of a peak, you know, and that in general then results into the next part, which is the recession phase. So what happens is, most often demand first starts declining. Because demand is declining, supply in turn tends to a little bit come down. And why demand is declining, or as a result of the supply going down, some other aspects of income, wages, salaries, they start to decline. Seedhi baat hai na sir, like if you're in the market, or if you're working in, let's say, FMCG or marketing, or if you're working with Paytm Money, you know, if broader sentiments and the cycle is slowing down, your salary will go down, your bonuses will reflect that, etc. So your tendency to demand for goods and services will a little bit come down. That automatically at some stage creates a buildup for a next part, which we can think of as the depression. Yeah. So just to recap again, like where I am in the cycle, you know, it's after the expansion, then I'm seeing a peak, and then a little bit of a recession, and then I'm seeing like a depression building up, or what we call as a situation where the economy continues to a little bit decline, and some bit of a, like, you know, unemployment that starts getting created. Then at that stage, there is another inflection point, or the trough, like the earlier inflection point after the expansion we saw was the peak, and here we see the trough. So the peak and the trough. So at this trough now, you come to the next phase, which is the recovery. And recovery tends to be, typically speaking, supply first. Because now there is a huge level of supply also building up. So demand is now gradually catching up. So again, both your demand and supply start increasing. and there is a so-called turnaround from the trough.
Yep.
This automatically lays the foundation of the next phase, which is the expansion from where we started. So expansion leading to some kind of an inflection point at a peak, then a little bit coming down, recession, in the trough, and coming to the recovery and coming back to the expansion. So it's a classic form of like cycle, if you think of it that way, with the two so-called inflection points self-generated. So during the previous phase, you are already seeing that, yes, yeah, now this, in this segment, in this sector, in this part of the economy, I'm starting to see a trough. And this is going to jumpstart the next phase of the recovery. So I hope, I was able to connect the earlier discussion and your point that there are these, broadly speaking, you know, four phases or you know, if you count even the peak and the trough, you know, as the inflection points, which are so interconnected and so visual that it's very crucial that while you are at one, you should be in a position to try to already forecast the next one.
So makes sense. I have a question before I move on to the next one.
Sure.
It's like, what do you feel, both of you? Okay. What do you feel, where are we right now in terms of business cycle, as of the current market standing of the economy? What do you feel, where are we?
So I want to go, like, okay, I'll go.
Yeah, any one of you can go.
So Raj, we are in the, as you know, Anil rightly mentioned, we are in that expansion phase now, where, okay, you know, what we've seen in the last year, and actually, you know, with activities coming back, interest rates low, you know, production high, also employment's gradually coming back. So we are in the expansion phase today.
So Anil, are we close to the peak or we are already at the peak?
I would feel we are not close to the peak in some form or fashion. Yes, we are in expansion, but I still feel taking a little bit of a bold call that we are in some parts of the economy in still recovery, and then some parts we are already in the expansion, you know. So the definitely the trough or the inflection point has been crossed. Recovery is there in many parts broadly. In some, we are already past the recovery phase or the segment and moved to the expansion. So it's a little bit soon to say we are at the peak.
Okay.
Because I feel that we'll still, come to that part. I mean, I don't want to go into stock specific or sector specific discussion, but in certain parts of the broader economy, I feel that the expansion is just getting started. So we have still some time for that expansion phase to work out. And then we can feel that, oh, now we are at the peak. But yes, already the foundation has been laid for some of those elements. We need to be clear about that and forecast that. That now gradually we'll reach to some level of peak, which will then lead to the next phase to kickstart.
Okay, so this is why I asked this question. How can you, both of you, say that, like, how did you get to know, or how do we get to know the point that, okay, we are in expansion phase, or we are in depression phase, or we are at the peak of everything? What are the indicators? Or I would say a better question would be, how do you monitor these business phases and figure out, okay, this is where we are, and this is probably going to be the next one? Siddharth, why don't you explain this?
Yeah, Raj, you know, thanks for this question. You know, it's a tough one, but I'll try to make it easy. You know, I think it's a known fact, Raj, that though these phases of business cycle are very recurrent in nature, they keep happening, the length and the dynamics of these phases does vary. And I think, as Anil rightly mentioned, you know, depending on which sector, at what phase it is. But, you know, as I said, different industries have their own cycles. There's no doubt about it. And dynamics, of course, this may not coincide with the stage of ongoing business cycle. So, you know, just to for our viewers, to make it very simple, hence, you know, pinpointing the exact date or time that, you know, at what phase of particular industry is tough. But, you know, there are various parameters which we can look at. And as money managers and as fund managers, you know, what we look at. And I think basically, you know, I would like to break it, Raj, into three things. You know, first thing is, you know, or more broader, that, you know, what are the economic parameters? As I started initially, you know, like, what is the current account deficit, the fiscal deficit, that, you know, at what phase of interest rates we are, how is the inflation? So, you know, this first point is typically those economic parameters which we look at. Then second comes the investment indicators, like, you know, are companies investing in their business? Is CapEx happening? Are they declaring newer projects? And, you know, what are the lead indicators reflecting in terms of the level of activity in the economy? So this is point second in terms of the investment indicators. And the last one, which is also extremely important, is the business, basically the business and consumer sentiment, you know, how it is. Are people buying more? So basically, you know, there's a barometer called, you know, PMI, Purchase Manager Index, which is a one indicator, you know, and we keep hearing the news about, you know, what is the business confidence index? Also the countries get rated in that way. You know, what is the sales of various discretionary items, what you and me are buying? So I think these are ways to decide whether we are in the expansion phase or the, you know, the contraction or the phase, etc. So what as fund managers we do is, you know, constant monitoring and tracking of these indicators, you know, and that not only happens with the current data, but also, you know, what's historically happened. Also, that's important to understand. And based on these inferences, you know, we draw the trend studies and possible scenarios towards identifying that, you know, what business cycle phase we are in and how to build our portfolios. And in continuation to what Anil has had rightly explained just in the previous question.
Got it. So I want to ask you, Anil, that what all should be the traits or the indexes as an individual investor we should keep in mind, which should help us get a better understanding of business cycles? Or like, can you tell us? I mean, obviously, everything is not very easy for us to track. It's also not going to make sense to most of the people who are just getting started or maybe are a retail investor. What can be, like, off the bat, 2 or 3 or 5 indexes or 5 things or 5 traits which we should keep in mind or we should keep a close watch on?
I think before I go into what to watch on, I'd just like to touch upon very briefly what Mr. Niranji mentioned in the beginning and what Siddharth touched upon. It's very crucial for all of us friends. While investing in capital markets or investing in your business or taking any view on business cycles, most important, most crucial is to look at history. The longer you look at history, the more important learnings you will get from history. Because however different we may think, certain key parts are very common because they are led by independent human behavior. So, understanding long trends of history is very crucial. Now, coming to connecting that with your question, then what are the 3-4 key things one should look at? Like, as we said, and as Siddharth, you also mentioned, like, you know, structurally, if you look at your final output, okay, what is your GDP or how the growth is happening, you know, there are a couple of key elements which are economic indicators what we track. You know, you can segment them broadly into 3 areas, I would feel. One is what we call as a lead indicators, okay, which in some form or fashion help us to predict those kind of inflection points for the turn, you know. Then the second is what we call as a coincident indicators. Okay. These are indicators which move along with the business cycles. And the third are the what we call as lag indicators. So lead indicators, lag indicators, and coincidental indicators. And some of these, like if you look at it, like Siddharth mentioned, like, you know, like we are looking at PMI, we are looking at the confidence index, you know, how the purchasing managers or the businesses are opening or loosening their purse strings. That gives an indication of the top-down perception of whether money is being put on the table. How is the credit offtake by the banks? You know, today, if suppose companies are operating at less than their optimum capacity utilization, on the other side, you know that if each of the companies don't even reach the level where they feel they are going to touch their peak capacity, you know, it's like okay, friends, all of you are watching this our discussion on your laptop or on your phone, right? You're using some bandwidth of your Wi-Fi in the home or in the office. Some of you are in the office, might be. If you are in your home, you have certain broad level of understanding how much bandwidth is being used. Now, if you know that for using this MasterClass Paytm event, I will need a bandwidth of, like, let's say, for example, X, and I have a very sufficient bandwidth, like, which is like 5X. So you will be comfortable. Give it chill, right? Boss, kya karna hai? But at that point, you know, kya boss, aaj to yaar, meri wife ka bhi koi call hone wala hai. And by the way, arre, might be mother is in the other room and she's going to watch abhi. You know, 7 p.m. is happening. So something Tarak Mehta ka Ulta Chashma is going to start. So boss, ye abhi, now I need to enhance my bandwidth. Boss, I need a new package to be purchased quickly before my Paytm Masterclass starts. Right? But those are the, connecting that to the world of business. I mean, when as a business, you feel that now I'm going to start hitting my capacity of utilization because these 3-4 engines are going to start firing. Boss, to come, let me go to the bank, let me raise some credit. Rate of take is there. I will need to start deploying money, invest money into my business or expand my factory, greenfield, brownfield, whatsoever might be. So these are the kind of important connectivity. So you will one look at credit of take, industrial production, employment, unemployment rates. You know, some of these help to come to this level of judgment of like, as we spoke about the lag indicators, lead indicators and coincidental indicators.
Oh, lovely. I love the analogy with how we can judge business confidence with bandwidth of my Wi-Fi. That makes it really easy for me to understand. Okay, I have a really interesting question, which is very direct from the audience. And sure. I think Arnab Ganguly asked this. So I want to ask you, Siddharth, and then I think I've got two interesting questions. Both of you, I'm going to ask one, okay? So Siddharth, people are asking, do we need to hold our investments for a longer time now, or do we sell off to book profits, considering we're just starting the expansion phase?
So I would say, you know, one size does not fit all. You know, it's extremely important to understand that, you know, with what goal you had invested, and also at the same time, you know, what returns you had put in terms of as a ballpark number. Of course, we all know that equities do create tons of wealth over long term, and I can just share with you whatever couple of years or a decade plus I've spent in the industry. I think this question comes up every time. It's extremely important to understand that, you know, what's your risk profile, what's your goal, and what returns you've set. And you know, of course, at times you need to review in terms of what's doing well and what's not doing well. But just by seeing that this is the return and, you know, and it's done well, and should I just move out, may at times be a shock. And just to share with you, let me just go back a year and a half, March, April, when COVID broke out. You know, everyone thought, you know, the world's going to come to an end. And I still remember in the industry for the first, those 3 or 4 months, there were quite a few people who were stopping their SIPs or redeeming. And just imagine, for maybe that time, it could have been a smart move, thinking that, oh, it's a great decision. But when I sit today and see, you know, if I'd stopped, it was a huge loss, or if I'd redeemed. So, you know, I think that's extremely important, according to me. But yes, if you've achieved your goal and there's no regret later that, no, oh, why did I move out? I think you should. But I think, and also at the same time, consult an advisor or go through experts. And, you know, of course, such lovely stuff, what also Paytm Money keeps publishing from time to time. And I'm sure the quality of advisor is only growing in the industry today.
No, it all makes sense. I think one of the key things which you mentioned, and I think we keep hearing again and again, but we often forget that, is we need to keep an eye on what is our goal and what is our risk profile. Because without that, there's nothing which you could, or Anil could, or anybody could advise anyone. And I think you are your own judge, and not one size fits everyone. That's what you said it brilliantly. So, like, revisiting our fundamentals or roots of being an investor is, I think, what everybody should think of when they're thinking of investments. Okay. So do you want me to make it more specific? Can I do that? So that, do I have the liberty to do that? We can make like an average Joe. Let's say, for example, young people, okay, around in their 25, 26 ish, 27, or maybe like in their early 20s or mid 20s, they just started earning. They are making their salaries. and they want to put it to buy a house one day when they're 40. Okay. So they have like a good 15, 20 years in their hand. What should they do? Like they should pull out or they should stop for a while? Now we have like a very specific thing.
Continue investing. And since you've got, you know, it's personal, you know, I started my SIPs when I was 24, and my first house, approximately 80% of the amount was funded through my SIP only when I bought.
Wow.
It's a real life story I can share.
Oh, lovely. Okay. I think that's a really good personal touch you added that fills a lot of people with hope. Because I think in India, we give top priority to buying a house and building a family and starting that. I think most of the young people, regardless of how much money they want to make or how soon they want to change the world, they need the house first. It's just filled in Indian mindset. All right. Thanks for answering that. Anil, I have a question for you. Is every sector goes through these different business cycles, but how to decide which sector is in recession and which is going through a boom? How does it affect stock prices as well?
So first of all, before I come to that, you know, on the lighter side, I just want to take this 30 seconds, a little bit digressing and raise this to Raj, not just you, but even to Niranji. Paytm Money does these excellent masterclasses. You know, I think this is the 18th or 19th. I've personally been tracking. I've been part of a couple of them, watching them, in a couple of them speaking. It's good learning. But these quizzes and the prizes are always for the audience to answer. There is never a prize for the speakers to give good answers. So we need
one,
to...
Anil, there's one coming my way, I'm sure.
Sorry, but I just want to take a minute to pause, to digress and give a recommend a thing to the way in which these business masterclasses are conducted. So I really appreciate that. And it also just to thank everyone who have joined these, that it's a great thing that you have decided to spend your time and effort and invest in that. So coming back to this question, in general, like when we look at certain sectors and like the, if I connect that with, let's say, how do we get a judgment that in this sector, are we now at the peak or you know, trough? Or I feel personally, it's a little difficult. It's always top down. And here I like to bring another very interesting concept. Friends, I like to, wherever I get a chance, you know, a little bit, not to boast about my collection of books. I have a small collection in my dealing room in my office, and friends around also always keep and borrowing whenever they want. So I always try to keep good recommendation for books. So there's this very interesting books called Mega Trends. Mega Trends.
Okay.
Okay. Like I said, mega caps, I would say mega trends, you know. So I would try to connect this with the concept of mega trends, where, you know, with the broader understanding of these business cycles, you need to try and dissect that into what could be mega trends and not just cycles. See, cycles are, broadly speaking, predefined. Okay, now I will come here now as, okay, we discussed, I will be in the recovery. So now I'm moving to expansion and then I will come back to a recession and like that way. But there will be certain sectors which will be the so-called mega trends, and they will be like into super cycles or they will surpass some of these cycles for a longer period of time. Yeah? So that's the key part to identify. It's not easy. I mean, but one needs to read a lot, talk about it, different sectors, what they are doing, which are the new age innovation that's coming up. And those could be the mega trends. Now, no doubt, the history of analyzing companies or analyzing sectors will always be useful. And on hindsight, you might feel that, oh, these are the, let's say, three mega trends I felt were important. And within those three mega trends, I tried to pick up 2 to 3 stocks and build them in my portfolio, for example. You know, here I'm talking about, not a very retail investor who is a average Joe, like you mentioned that. For him or her, I would strongly recommend don't go by the effort needed for this kind of analytics. Just come to a low cost passively managed mutual fund like an ETF or an index fund to get started with. Then once you get more aware of economic trends, financial markets, etc., you gradually move to that and selecting stocks or sectors. But this I'm talking about a little bit somebody more informed investor, because the question, I believe, has come from slightly informed investor, because he or she has tried to ask sector specific and then stock specific. So I'm trying to connect the dots. So then that could be a good way to feel that on hindsight, maybe one or two of those companies, even if you are right in identifying the mega trends which grow well, but definitely from that, you know, each of those companies will not do well. Like I'll maybe take a slightly unique example. Like, you know, when we go to, let's say, observe in a, like a zoo or in a, like a sanctuary, like, you know, a segment or area where there are monkeys, you know, so typically speaking, how their behavior is that there will be like a family of monkeys, 10, 15, 20 monkeys. Then typically speaking, amongst them, one emerges as the leader, basically, you know, and the others come out as a monkey, basically. With all due respect, monkeys are very good animals. I appreciate them very much. But just as an example, likewise, when you have identified that particular two mega trends or three mega trends and try to pick up three, four companies, maybe after some time you realize that from that, there is only one who is the, like, the leader of that mega trend. The others were monkeys, and you need to reduce your weightage in them, identify that leader monkey and overweight that and continue to ride that mega trend. Like somewhat, if you look at, let's say, in hindsight, let's say in the early to mid 90s, if one was able to identify that technology and internet and et cetera are going to be the mega trends, no doubt at that point of time, sitting in early 90s, you know, I would have never imagined we will be in like a so-called industrial revolution 4.0, where today we are talking about Internet of Things. That scale of the growth of that mega trend, like, you know, was not anticipated. But yes, if one could have identified that time, and you would have, without taking names of some companies, if at that point of time, let's say even in late 90s, you know, before the dot-com bust, if you would have identified 5-7 companies, you know, six of them would have gone, you'd have come to know they are monkeys, and only the one or two would be the leaders, which you need to continue investing and holding into your portfolio. So I hope, I mean, I was able to respond to you, whosoever raised the question, but slightly in a broader manner, I try to identify how you should try to look at slightly bigger, capture mega trends, and then try to select few companies within that. No doubt it's difficult, yet from the first cut it will be clear, but that's how you should try to look at creating your portfolio.
Yeah, that makes ton of sense. But now I want to ask you more straight question. Okay, I love doing that, Siddharth. We all say that the way to create wealth or safeguard your wealth is diversification, is asset allocation, right? So what are the different assets for different phases of business cycle? That I want to know. And the second part of it, can you briefly explain about how did you allocate your assets, or how did you allocate your money so that you can gain the maximum and try to achieve the kind of goals which you had?
Yeah, so you know, this is a extremely important question, which, you know, at times, you know, we talk about it, but when it comes to acting on it, you know, we may do a good job or may not do that great job with it. So, you know, asset allocation, we all know, to put it very, very simply, Raj, is, you know, it's like an investment strategy where, you know, you divide your portfolio amongst various asset classes, you know, and what our fathers, grandfathers have been doing also in the past, they also have been doing asset allocation. Maybe the kind of investment avenues have gone up today, but, you know, the basic framework remains the same. So, what are the assets you can be investing in? You can be investing in equity or stocks, you can be investing in bonds or fixed deposits, real estate, gold, or keep cash at, you know, at home also. That's also a way of asset allocation, because, you know, you're trying to, have an emergency fund. So, you know, all these are, you know, form part of an asset allocation. And what I view it as is, you know, a well-planned asset allocation strategy is extremely crucial to one's achieving one's life goals, which I just touched upon previously. And what's more important is to balance it out so that, you know, your overall portfolio, you know, the risk is also taken care of, but at the same time, you know, you optimize your returns. So, you know, just to share, you know, asset classes like, you know, equity, real estate, gold, you know, since we're talking about business cycle, you know, they tend to do well during the expansion or the peak phase, you know. So just to share, you know, this is typically, I'm not saying exactly I'm bang on in terms of what does well, but typically that's a broad thing I'm mentioning. But then, you know, when you hit a slump or a recessionary phase, you know, your defensive stocks tend to do better, or you end up going into bonds also. So I think that's a typical way of doing asset allocation. You know, I can, you know, we can spend hours and hours on this, Raj, but, you know, I'm just trying to keep it very, very crisp. But if you were to ask me personally, and, you know, it's a very common way, but it does help about, you know, that thumb rule of 100 minus your current age, you know, though it may sound boring, but, you know, it does make sense, because I also try to do it. And I know a lot of friends, investors also, who try to, at least, I'm not saying have achieved whatever exactly they wanted, but, you know, whatever is your current age, and 100 minus your current age should be the thing into equity. But at the same time, you need to review it. You know, it's not a very, very simple recipe. You know, it has to be reviewed from time to time. But of course, you know, when you're young, you know, and a very young person like you, Raj, I'm sure you should be going all out investing more in equity. But you know, for a person who's you know, going to touch 45, 46 now, you know, I'll try to balance it. But of course, at core, I'm still a very hardcore equity guy. But then the good part is, as Anil was rightly mentioning, you know, mutual funds per se today offer you every product category in asset allocation. You know, having cash at hand, you know, you have liquid funds there are complementary products, you know, which are like fixed deposits. Also through in mutual funds, you can invest in gold, you can invest in real estate. So, you know, why to go anywhere else? Mutual funds are available way for forward. Any asset class.
Yeah. Also, like, guys, for the audience, I want to mention, like, these are just personal opinions. These are not to be taken as hardcore written rule for anything or everything which you do as per investments. I'm sure different kind of investments and different kind of advices work for different people, and you must have different principles based on Siddharth's experience he's sharing, based on Anil's experience what he's sharing. So don't take it as this is a written code somebody have given us and this is not the guidelines to live by. But
These are thumb rules. It's nothing.
These are only thumb rules as per individuals. So yeah, I think I'll tell you a quick story. I made a video on how at the age of 24, I invest in seven different asset classes. Okay. And there were different classes I was talking about. There were arts as well, because I'm like really into art and all of that. So I made that video and there was a lot of backlash from people and be like, okay, yaar, this is what you're suggesting us to do. I'm like, no, this is not what I'm suggesting you to do. My risk profile is good as of now. So this month, as of now, it makes sense. Tomorrow, when my responsibilities go higher, because today I'm single, I live alone, I don't have parental responsibility, I don't have kids responsibility. So my goals are different and my approach to investments are completely going to be different as well. So that is what I think people should also keep in mind. Keep whatever the age they have, the responsibilities they have, and the risk profile they have. All right, Anil, I have another direct question. Is, I think somebody from the team only mentioned this, that which sectors are the best performers in the bull phase? Because we all keep saying again and again that this is the bull phase of the market. This is what we're going. This is where in the middle of it. What are the sectors which are the best performers as of today, if somebody wants to get in?
See, I think I'll hold to what I mentioned earlier, that structurally, it's very crucial to try and identify those mega trends so that you don't have to worry about the intermittent phases. But if specifically, if you think of it like, you know, somebody is very closely tracking markets and wants to take tactical calls, that, okay, at this phase now, these one or two sectors will do better. And then like, okay, when I'm coming to the next part of the business cycle and I'm going to touch the, trough and start the, you know, moving upward. So after touching a trough and starting to see the uptick, usually, I mean, I would say broadly speaking, sectors like financials, you know, BFSI, like technology, IT, they start doing well. Why? Because structurally, like just recall earlier what I said, at the trough, you know, not much is happening. People are getting less of increments and salaries and blah, blah. So what are you going to do? You're going to start generating a demand, and to fulfill that demand, you are watching now on the Paytm .com website, you know, that there are new sale going up for a new fancy mobile costing 1 lakh rupees. Suppose my case long of 1 lakh. Okay, I'll go to the leverage. I will have a loan or kind of a easy paid later scheme, and I'll take leverage. So be a banking and financial services become the core aspects of that.
Yeah.
Next, if you move, like the IT will be the driver. You know, the technology related parts will do well. Little bit further, if you look at it, I mean, you know, some parts of, you know, the around that time, government will come into the picture for the government spending, you know, the way where some fiscal stimulus will start coming, infrastructure spending and all will start happening. So it will connect with, let's say, cement, steel, road construction, you know, a lot of the infra spending, capital goods, that kind of area or theme. Just I'm taking one step behind. This is like not only stock specific, but masterclass learning, right? So when you think of GDP, how do you put the formula for GDP? GDP is nothing but C plus I plus G plus X minus M means net of imports, right? So C is what? Consumption. I is the investment. G is the government spending, right? So we started from the C, the consumption part, where to need the consumption, you need the banking, you need the credit uptake, and you start the growth engine. Then, like, you know, the G part sometimes come in because government also is realizing that, yes, there is a too much of a long time of trough, and like, I need to also, like, what can we do to spur up and support the, like, I mean, GDP. So the government spending part will happen. So this part of the capital goods, cement, steel, etc. And then structurally, as we move further, you know, the other sectors will catch up. Like, you know, we'll see consumer discretionary, like, you know, people are now going to buy their own new vehicle or, okay, spend money to paint their homes or buy new houses and do the refurbishing with the white goods, I mean, like that way. And you know, structurally, but within this, one has to always remember that some sectors will always be ongoing. Like, for example, healthcare, structurally, I would say. Like, for example, I still feel financials, though people feel like, as I also mentioned, that it could be at the kickstarting part, but I feel structurally, if you think of it as a broad megatrend for a country like India or any other similar quote-unquote developing market or emerging market, you know, I feel very strongly, I've said this multiple times, even in some of the other Paytm masterclass or in public domain, finance is the lifeblood for any growing economy or any developing economy. So different segments of the BFSI industry at different points will do very well. At some point of time, the balance sheet heavy model, like a bank, NBFC, HFCs, housing finance companies, will do very good. Mm. At some part of the cycle where they are starting to see some stress build up in their asset book, the other part of the BFSI industry, like the balance sheet light model, like, you know, which will start doing very good, which are into like companies involved in, let's say, insurance, asset management, wealth management, you know, which need capital, but they are not using capital as the raw material, you know, so balance sheet light model versus balance sheet heavy model, but within the BFSI sector, things are going good. So concluding the discussion, like, you know, some sectors, one can say, okay, in the bull run, this is at the starting of the bull run, this will do good, a little bit more upward, the other will do good. In recovery phase, which are the sectors, and structurally at the bottom of it, you know, the core part of, you know, the identified trends, you know, will always continue to be there. That's how I would look at it in terms of our capital markets currently. Maybe it could change in next couple of years or whatever, but
I'm really happy about the fact that I asked you this question, because one of my personal theories got validated there. Okay. So I was like, I'm really happy for that. I read a study a while ago, I think 2 years or 3 years ago, where it said that earlier in our parents' generation, our parents, they were out of 10, 8 of them used to save. They was not spending. They were like the saving generation, right? And in our generation, out of 10, only 2 save. 8 other ones were spending. So we are getting towards this consumer behavior. We are getting into spending mentality. We are getting to credit mentality. We are more worried about how much credit card spending limit we can get versus how much we can save. So because we want more things. So all of a sudden, there's a shift in the mindset that we want better lifestyle than to have better, pool of amount to in our banks. So I think that's where your consumerism think makes a lot of sense. You look at the patterns and the trends around you and look at from the broader perspective, the country as well. And maybe that will make sense and help you identify the right sectors.
Good point. But Raj, I would like to connect it with slightly different aspect of today's discussion, business cycles. Like what I said in the beginning, each of the phase of the business cycle is so interconnected. Likewise, it's nothing that parents galat sochte the, bachche log aaj naya sochte, wo galat sochte, aisa nahi hai. Wo apne taraf sahi soch rahe the in those days. Raj and Siddharth ji and Neeraj ji, the business cycles had much more longer duration. Okay, now today business cycles are shorter. So today, yeah. In that sense, the people who started their earning profile, who started their salaries, they're already, like we said, in each of those four phases, each are interconnected. While you are in one phase, you're already laying the foundation of the next. So that young professional who has just started working in the, let's say, Paytm's marketing division, a couple of our friends are there who set up this call for us, or some of them who are working in, let's say, engineering, with a large some conglomerate who have just started working. They know from now that they are right now also in that gradual expansion phase. So their balance sheet, their wealth is going to expand. So they are taking the leverage, they are expanding the credit card limits and spending. Why not? It's a perfect thing.
Yeah, makes sense. There's also one thing which my father used to say, I don't know if it makes sense to everybody, is when I asked my father about this thing, that, about the business cycles, they used to last much longer previously. So he says, in easier way, if I have to explain you, it would be in today's generation, you get fired fast and hired faster. Okay. So he was like, it's very easy for you to find another job if you get fired from your existing job, because you can learn about a new skill from the internet and find and completely replace your entire position. But for us, if we find a job, we have to stick with that job forever. Or if we get fired out of that job, we have to go back to the degree, get 3-4 years of college done, and then again join a new company to start something. So I think that time, that also makes a lot of sense, that for us, opportunities are much more. That's why we think in a different way versus how they were thinking. So it all depends on the time and the generation, everything. So nothing is right, nothing is wrong. The last question I would ask you is, I think I have two more questions, if that's okay. So one is, we go with Anil, what is the difference between systematic and unsystematic risk? Because investing is risky. That's what they all say.
Of course.
But there's a thing called systematic risk and there's a thing called unsystematic risk. What are these? Can you explain it to an average person like me?
Yeah, sure. I was about to come to that. Before we entered, we are doing the test and everything, And if somebody would have asked, something very technical, okay, boss, what is the RAM and what is this? I can't even speak those words in your system. And boss, kisko samajh mein aata hai? Khali bol diya ki saab aapka volume on karo, main idhar se check kar rahi hu. Voice is clear, okay, thumbs up. Video is clear, thumbs up. Comfortable. And we go kickstart. Likewise, systematic risk, unsystematic risk, diversifiable risk, all that is fun, useful. But in layman term, think of it that some part of your risk, which is inherent in what you do, okay, I entered into the session, right? Though I had the best of the, my laptop and my Wi-Fi and everything first class, and we checked it, right? But still, I have an inherent risk. Arey bhai, kya malum kaun se tower se mera connection aa raha hai? Wo tower mein bijli chali gayi, boss. Connection down, right? Neeraj ji, next time se bulayenge, Anil bhai, aapko to bulana hi nahi hai, kabhi Paytm Masterclass, aap chale gaye, beech chhod ke, right? That's a classic way to determine systematic risk, what you said. Systematic risk is something which you cannot diversify away. It's a market risk in our terminology. Ke bhai bazar girega, to aap jo bhi sector ho, defensive ho, stock acha hai, company best hai, it will correct.
Yeah.
Okay. And structurally, what is the non-systematic or the unsystematic risk sometime, what we call, or sometimes there is a, like a, something which are company specific risk, you know, which you can in some form or fashion diversify away. Acha Anil bhai, aapka kaun sa wifi bata dijiye? Oh, I have wifi of XYZ company. I'm not taking any company name also because many of them are in listed space. And madam is saying ke, oh Anil bhai, please na ek saath mein dusra ek wifi on rakho bhai. Okay, to ye nahi hua to wo switch kar denge. Okay, yes, perfect, I agree. That is the unsystematic risk which I can diversify away. If one service provider's Wi-Fi goes down, other is go up, can go up.
Yeah.
Mind you, this is different from the thing that where the overall tower is sitting in my area at in Mumbai. If that goes down, irrespective
everything
of
goes
whoever is service provider, I can't do anything. So, classic example of systematic risk, tower going down, bajar gir gaya. Okay, everything is in a downward declining trend. Second part, unsystematic risk, company specific risk, you know. So-called diversifiable risk, you know, with prudent risk measures, with fancy systems, you can determine that and work with multiple stocks and sectors in the portfolio and try to make sure that that particular non-systematic risk can be diversified away. And then that non-systematic risk further can broadly be into two parts. One is a business risk and the financial risk. I mean, you know, so that's fine. I mean, that then that goes into the more specific aspect. कि भाई धंधे में कुछ इश्यू हो रहा है या ओवरऑल फाइनेंशियल एस्पेक्ट्स आर गेटिंग अ ट्रबल ऑफ दैट पर्टिकुलर कंपनीज परफॉर्मेंस एक्सेट्रा यू नो दैट इज द सेकंड पार्ट ऑफ योर अनसिस्टमैटिक रिस्क बट एट द टॉप लेयर वेरी गुड क्वेश्चन ऑल ऑफ अस हु आर इनटू द वर्ल्ड ऑफ इन्वेस्टिंग आई एम सॉरी आई डाइग्रेस्ड टू अ लेमैन एग्जांपल सो दैट आई कुड कनेक्ट इट हियर सो दैट माइंड में फिट हो गया बहुत अच्छा बाजार में इन्वेस्ट कर रहे यस कर रहे तो आपको सिस्टमैटिक रिस्क लेके ही चलना पड़ेगा इट्स नॉन डाइवर्सिफाइबल non-diversifiable risk. It can be caused by anything, political, social, blah, blah, anything. But it can't be diversified again. And the second part is unsystematic risk, you know, company-specific risk, which you can think comes from microeconomic, not macroeconomic, micro factors, company-specific factor, management change ho gaya, some whistleblower announcement, anything like that way, you know, labor union strike, etc., like that way. That, yes, it's our duty as good investors to be creating our portfolio in such way that it's as well diversified and as robust as possible.
Thank you so much for answering that. Siddharth, the one last question, I don't want to keep you guys waiting for long. And the one last question is, how do we optimize our wealth specific to business cycles? Let's say on a very, very simple terms is if I've invested, let's say in XYZ stock, they're doing really well. Now I know they're at the peak. Now they start seeing the downward trend because obviously the entire market is going down. So there's going to be some correction, right? So do I pull out my investments and then wait for it to go down really, really down and then again invest and get in the market, or do I just leave as it is? So what is the optimal utilization strategy for my money or for my investments?
So thanks, Raj, for this final question. You know, as I think in detail we've discussed today, and I think that's what business cycle funds or business cycle, you know, give that opportunity to investors to invest in. So, you know, to put it very simply, you know, when an economy is, and as we talked about, is in the expansionary phase, you know, of course, the cyclical commodities, real estate tend to do well. And during the peak and contraction phase, you know, it's better to shift allocation towards, you know, the defensive asset classes because, you know, they've had the run up. And of course, you know, when you hit the slump, you know, you're much better off, again, getting those, you know, as we say, aggressive mode where you finally, you know, shift to riskier assets and non-defensive sectors. So, you know, as we discussed, you know, every asset and every cycle has its advantage. And, you know, how I would like to coin it, Raj, is, you know, through a business cycle, you know, you can really build a portfolio that seeks to keep you ahead of time. And I think that's what we always think about. Then, you know, how can I be ahead of time in a positive spirit, I'm saying. And that's how, you know, if one is able to get it right, and of course, through business cycle concept and funds, which we've also launched. So, you know, I think this is the way to go about it.
Thank you so much, Siddharth, for answering that and making it really clear for everyone. Thank you so much, Anil, for joining. I think both of you answered most of our questions, tried to make it really easy with the analogies which you guys gave us. And so that's personally, thanks for sharing that one anecdote that this is how, and this was one of your favorite strategy to get the house done. And Anil, thanks for making it easy and layman for, you know, for every layman who's understanding, who has no clue about market. So by explaining whether it's Wi-Fi or it's any other thing related to towers, I'm really happy that you did it. Thank you so much, guys. It's a brilliant session. I hope that Paytm Money keeps doing something like this so that we get to interact more often. And I would love to connect with you guys on the after the Paytm session as well. Thank you so much for joining.
Thank you very much, Raj, for very beautifully structuring this in a 1 hour session and extracting the maximum out of both Siddharth and me. Really appreciate it. Friends, thank you very much. All the best for the rest of the masterclass session. And I hope all of you enjoy winning the prizes. All the best. Neeraj, thank you very much.
Thanks, Raj. And thanks, Neeraj, for getting me in this session. Really enjoyed. And Raj, thanks for getting the best out of us.
Thank you. All right, guys. This is it. Now let's just shift and dive into the next session and hoping that everybody wins.
Yes. Okay. We are still on live.
Yeah.
We are live, Vivek. Okay. Guys, thank you, Raj. Thank you, Siddharth and Anil, for this wonderful and stimulating panel discussions. I'm sure all our participants have gained immensely, got a good insight into the cycles, business cycles, and will definitely help them in their investments. Thank you so much, guys. So before we go for a break of 5 minutes, I'd like to tell you that next session is by Mr. A. Balasubramaniam. He is the MD and CEO of Aditya Birla Sun Life AMC. And the topic is going to be industry analysis. And also, before we get into a break for 5 minutes, I would request all the participants to give a feedback on the session that we had. And see you guys after the break. Thank you. welcome back, guys. The topic for this session is industry analysis by Mr. A. Balasubramanian. Now, let me quickly introduce Balasubramanian, sir. He is the managing director and CEO of Aditya Birla Sun Life AMC Limited. He has been associated with the organization since 1994, prior to assuming his role as a CEO in 2009. Balasubramanian served as a chief investment officer. As MD and CEO, Mr. Balasubramanian oversees over 3.1 lakh crores of asset under management at Aditya Birla Sun Life AMC. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Balasubramanian has been awarded CEO of the Year title by AC Asset Management in 2018 and 2020. He has been awarded Chairman's Award as Chairman's Individual Award by Aditya Birla Group for being Outstanding Leader in 2015 and for being Leader of Leaders in 2018. So I'd like to welcome Bala sir onto the stage. Sir, can you switch on your camera, please?
Yeah, thanks, Niraj. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Stage is all yours. You can share your PPT, sir.
Sure. Thanks. Yeah. Thanks, Niraj. First of all, thanks for having me part of this show. I remember the last masterclass session which I attended with your other Krishidhar and the colleague, and that's something which I really enjoyed being part of your forum and taking questions from all your viewers. I'm happy to be back the same masterclass for the second time. So I have a presentation. I think if we can load that presentation. I think the topic I just heard, the earlier one, the business cycle and how industry functions, especially in the market. So today's session, I just thought, instead of talking about the mutual fund industry, which normally I speak about, rather let me talk about how the market in general behaves in various phases. I think if we go to the next slide, clearly, we actually look at the market in two or three cycles. If you look at the chart here, the market goes through an expansion phase, then it goes to a contraction phase, and then peak phase and slump phase. And this is the general behavior of the market. In every cycle, during this period of pandemic, I used to say the same thing in the form of in four different ways. I used to say that one, we go through a despair phase. Sometimes, many times, the economic slowdown happens. If we think anything that we see is dark, anything we see and hear around is a pessimistic. And then suddenly you see things start changing. And then you go to the hope phase and optimism phase. And then the growth phase comes and optimism phase subsequently is continues. And that's something the four business phases in which market goes in cycles. And the reason I am saying this is clearly the market by the long run is not like a weighing machine. It remains very, very steady and stable for longer term point of view. And intermittent market goes through cycles. Let's go to the next cycles. Next slide. See, market is at the end of the day is getting influenced, right? I think I always say all of us get influenced in our own way. And we must also remember the market also get influenced. So one nice phase is one part. And each of the phase, all of us, as a investor in the market, money manager in the market, and the various people who operate in the market in the economy, they get influenced on the basis of various things that comes in. I call it as a key economic indicators. And whenever you look at the influencing factors, various economic factors such as the economic activities can be measured in the form of credit growth. If somebody borrows, it's good sign. Somebody doesn't borrow, they also get a bad sign. That means nobody wants to actually borrow and expand. And second is corporate earnings that keep changing. See, corporate earnings, I generally call it as a stock price, is a slave of the earnings. Stock price is a slave of the earnings. The earnings is good, stock price goes up. The earnings is bad, stock price comes down. That's the way you look at the key indicators. Second is when the company, of course, runs various levels like inventory levels, company announced suddenly CapEx. There used to be a period when I was a money manager in those days. the capex is to be considered as a bad word. In the sense, yeah, the capex, somebody is doing it when already people are not there to buy goods. So that's the way we used to think that capex can actually play a role in cycle in which you are doing. If the expansion drive, capex cycle has got a positive impact. If there's already a peak and excess capacity there, still go for capex, could have a negative impact. The same way, the market, there is a demand slump and a slowdown, and somebody goes for capex, will have a negative impact. The same way, we also measure the success of every company is on the basis of the operating model. I think all of us know that if all of us needs more mobile phone, suddenly you find, like, you figure out companies are not producing enough mobile phone for you and me to buy. Just imagine what could happen. Suddenly you'll see the prices going up because the demand supply situation is completely changing. Therefore, the tracking the capex also has a greater impact in the market. And finally, of course, interest rate, monetary policy, all these things do matter. Again, I'll give you some examples that when I was a bond trader, there used to be a time where I used to sit on the desk and trade in the bond market and also in the equity market. And many times, look at the monetary policy, which is nothing but Reserve Bank of India comes with a policy nowadays, every 2 months it comes. In those days, it used to come every 6 months. In those days, it used to come every 6 months and became 3 months. Whenever the monetary policy being announced by Reserve Bank of India, and of course, it has an impact on interest rates, borrowing cost, liquidity, and so on and so forth. And all of us used to look at how well the monetary policy is looking at the various economies. And all these things have got influence in the market. When you're in an expansion phase, when you reach a peak, it has its own impact. When the contraction or slump happens, it has its own impact. I think we'll just go to the next slide. And on the basis of that, clearly, if you look at this chart on the left side, the GDP growth, again, has an influence. I think as the GDP growth is actually fluctuates on the each of these phases, clearly, we have seen, I myself have seen in the period between 2006 and 2007, we all used to argue in the Indian market that 10% above in GDP growth is given. There is no question on that. And Montesquieu Aluwalia was the planning commission chairman. And then we used to make a public statement that GDP growth, we need to only start thinking how far the 10% plus it will be sustained. And not about, there is no talk about GDP growth coming down. But that's something is actually the peak of the bullishness. So that's why I think the influencing factors, that the length of the phase of influencing factor. Fortunately, today, the monetary policy that has come post-pandemic, 2 years continuously, the Monetary Policy Authority, the Reserve Bank of India, talks about interest rate being low, liquidity is being high. They are not even talking about hiking the interest rate. We know very well Indian government has been borrowing through the fiscal and expanding the market. This is the new phase that we are seeing. That every phase goes through certain cycles on the basis of the various dynamics that happens. See, on the basis of this, the next slide, if we go, on the basis of this, what I just mentioned before itself, in my first slide, the market goes through various phases, then optimism to fear to panic and despair phase, and hope and optimism phase. Definitely each of these phases, investors' behavior also changes. And these investors' behavior changes, thinking that I'm going to lose a lot of my money, therefore let me sell. Thinking that I'm going to make a lot of money and therefore you continue to hold on to your investment and don't sell. I mean, both the things happen. And that's where the market gets influenced. And where does it help on this basis of this? Clearly the behavior is there, which is of course fluctuating. And as a result of that, expectation keep changing from time to time. And various factors that influence the market also keep changing on time-to-time basis. And that ultimately detects the fluctuation in the market. Interestingly, I just wanted to give you one sense on that. I think as a common man, as an investor, see, all of whatever I'm mentioning, so we all as a money manager track it. Most of the managers across the globe, sort of global, track it. But for a common man, from investor's point of view, should I track all such things on the basis of which I also keep changing my view on a time-to-time basis and taking a view on the market? Or should I just stay invested and leave the job to the professional money manager like us and let all of us carry the tension, pressure, and that's what we are paid for, and then take a call on the market? That's the way the worldwide it functions. And that's on the basis of if we do it. Let's just want to show you the trend in the next slide. Next slide. If you see this slide, despite all the things that I talk about, is the key economic indicators influence the market. And if you see this slide, I just took a slide which is a 20-year business cycle and how markets are performed. First and foremost, I just want to draw your attention. In this slide, if you see, there is a chart. There's a 20-year chart. This 20-year chart have gone through ups and downs, right? You'll see the chart not being one straight line, but it goes ups and downs. But ultimately, if you look at the longer term chart from 2001, 2021, then upward chart. There's absolutely no doubt it's not a smooth ride. It's not a one-sided upside movement. It has gone through ups and downs. I think if you look at each of these, I just look at this market cycle in three-year cycles. I look at the market in a three-year cycle, 2001, 2003, 2004, 2006, and so on and so forth. I think I just had one simple observation, though I'm not a technical expert, and therefore for me to give a technical view, clearly on the basis of various influencing factors, how the market also behaves. The market behaves volatility is high. The market goes ups and downs every 3 years. But the fact of the matter is GDP is growing, industry is growing, consumer behavior is getting better. Therefore, each 3 year period, the market forms a new high, it forms a bottom, again forms a new high, it forms a bottom. But the fact of the matter is the bottom of the next 3 year is higher than the previous 3 year bottom. Your bottom is here, the next 3 years bottom is here. The next 3 years again bottom is higher. It's basically called the higher bottom and higher tops. So this is the way the market behaves on the base of this. Therefore, from an investor's point of view, anybody who makes investments in the capital market, in the equity market, they must keep this in mind. Market will go through cycles of different phases. At the end of the day, from investor's point of view, they need to keep the confidence and optimism in mind that in the long run, market will continue to rise. Then taking the sector's calls, taking the various businesses that actually perform well at different point of time, which we'll talk about in a while, that the money manager's job to ensure that those calls are being taken, taking into account various factors that influence the sectors and market on the basis of which it does the portfolio allocation. When there's a portfolio, that's what the business cycle fund is supposed to act on the basis of which. I just want to show you the next slide on the basis of what I just mentioned earlier. Also on the basis of what I just mentioned as the guidance and message to all the investors, I think if you see this slide, you'll see a lot of boxes. And I'm not asking you to look at each of the boxes more in details and see what is the relevance of this. I just measure this on the basis of just one. I think if you look at, there are many columns, FI12, FI13, FI14, FI15, and goes up to FI22 year to date. And each boxes, the colors represents one sector. One sector represents the one which is above the line is a positive return. The one which is below the line, the median line which is there, below the line is negative return. The way I think you ought to measure this, the number of times the various sectors given a positive return, which is above the line, I think you can pictorially, you can just imagine, you can just see it, the number of sectors who have performed above the line giving a positive return is far higher than the number of sectors given negative return on below. And where does it happen? I think the contraction period, if you see, the contraction period, when it contracts, that's the period when things are getting controlled and economy is getting contracted. Therefore, the number of sectors perform well in that period, relatively less. Or maybe the number of sectors doing badly and doing well, probably you can say both are somewhat equal. Whereas if you take the expansion period, I think if you take the expansion period from 14 to 17 or 18 period, the number of sectors who are actually on the above the line and performing better are actually far higher, or the number of sectors are actually performing bad and below the line and below the median line. So that's the way I think one has to see this, because the expansion period, a lot of investment happens, the customer behavior is getting better, a lot of investment happens from the government of India, and therefore every sector actually have got their own field day that we can call it, in order to generate higher revenue, earnings, and that influence the market and sectors. Therefore, each of them tend to perform better than the market. There are a few sectors, of course, perform better than was than the market. Again, if you look at the subsequent period, expansion period, again, they go through the same cycle. And you go through these kind of cycles, you see different sectors performing differently. And that's something majority of the time provides a money manager an opportunity to look at those sectors and have it part of the portfolio in the form of overweight, underweight. I think when we consider the portfolio many times, that's the way the money manager operates, that okay, I'm bullish on banking. The question is, what is the weight of the banking index in the index and how much I should own in my portfolio, more or less, right? These are the only two decisions one has to take from a longer term portfolio construction point of view. Really on the base of this, next slide, if you look at, on the base of various sectors which I just talked about, clearly I just want to give a few illustrations on few sectors, how they behave. Clearly, I think pharma is a sector, if you see, it's influenced by various things. So I generally call it as a pharma in a two period. One is the domestic pharma sectors, overseas pharma sectors. And pharma sectors, given the fact that they have two segments of the people to cater to. One, the domestic investors. That means that all the production that happens in India are controlled by, I call it as a DPCO, which is the pharmaceutical, the agency which controls the prices in India. And second, of course, is the US generic market. It's pretty large. They look at India's outsourcing units. And therefore, most of the pharmaceutical companies who are in the exports market, catering to the various needs of the global producers in the form of giving API. And that's something they use it actually as the formulation. And then they make actually the final product for which they get probably the raw material from India. There are 2-3 models are there. I think clearly if you look at the various phases when there is a pressure coming from US, especially in the form of FDA inspection that happened about a few years back, pharma as a sector did not do well. And because the earnings are getting impacted, a lot of the influencing which was coming from regulation, and therefore they went through a cycle. At the same time, the same set of companies, during the COVID period when the opportunity suddenly opened up, the pharma sector again did exceedingly well. And this is the way I think they go through, and that's something which again I thought I'll give an example. Second, if we take, I think the next one, if we take the technology sectors, next slide. Again, technology sectors, clearly I think the huge expansion. I think I personally have seen the technology sector going through a complete rough weather. There was a period, it went through very rough weather. And 1992 or 94, I would say, when Infosys came to the market for listing, believe me, none of us understood how technology is going to play a role. I'm talking about way back in 90s then. And then there's a complete wave of India outsourcing came in, thanks to the US, and they didn't, of course. In fact, if you ask me, the sector which actually saved India is actually technology sector, become the one of the largest provider of technology service to the US. Then only I think other companies, of course, started becoming bigger and bigger in the US. And that's something went through the period. It, of course, gets influenced by spending power of companies, the spending needs of the companies, consumer behavior changing on the basis of technology adaptations, and so on and so forth. In fact, the last few years, these entire sectors have been getting benefit out of the, I mean, next slide, I think on to the pharma sectors. Yeah, the technology sectors have gone through a massive growth thanks to the US spending on various requirement on technology side. The other area we always used to think, especially post Lehman Brothers crisis, and most of the regulators and globally, they started insisting that every bank and financial sector in the world have to become tighter on the compliance, the regulatory framework which they have to implement, which essentially means the more the compliance, the more the change in the way the company being operating, I think clearly there is one spending that happens big time for everybody, the investment on technology. Every company have an allocation to a technology spending. This something again goes through a cycles. Whenever we do the reduction in the spending on technology, it has an impact, it has a negative impact. Whenever the technology expenses goes up, it has a positive impact. So that's the way it actually influences the market quite substantial. Automation is something makes it compulsory for technology companies to do well. The same way, if you look at metal as next segment, if you see, I think metal as a sector also has got a greater influence on the various economic growth. I think first and foremost, influence that is to come, I have seen these sectors for some number of years. Clearly, the sector which generally is the most profitable, the most important sectors for creating employment, a sector which actually provides a greater revenue to the state in the form of encouraging mining that happens in every country for production of steel, aluminium, and so on and so forth. And India being one of the rich country for natural resources, again, it goes to its own, it has got its own fluctuations. But also, we must remember, this sector has got a greater influence on spending that come from various government expenditure that happens. China is one of the bigger influencers of spending in the world. The more they spend in building roads, real estate, ports, and various things, the natural demand for steel, aluminium, everything goes up. Therefore, suddenly you'll see the rise coming in. In fact, the last 3 years, thanks to the ESG, the way environmental issue that came up in the global market, naturally, the company that has been digging, doing mining activities, they come under attack, and because of the pollutions, and then you're doing damage to the earth and so on and so forth. So again, you go through a pain period. So this is the way I think the fluctuation happens. Clearly, this sector is driven by the demand and supply, and the spending on government in building various infrastructure. Therefore, it goes through the phases. Therefore, this sector also provides a different kind of return, taking into account various influencing factors coming both in up cycle as well as in the down cycles. Further go down to the next one, the next slide. This is again capital goods sectors. Again, the big sectors provides greater employment and provides greater manufacturing, the needs, as well as the most needed of the most essential from the system point of view in terms of building the companies on the base of the spending alone. These are just related directly to the spending by the government, private sector and expansion. This also sector goes through ups and down cycles. And that's something we believe where we are today. The world, as I speak, just about a few days back, the Biden government announced $1 trillion investments in infrastructure building in US. What does it mean? That $1 trillion investment in building infrastructure. Infrastructure means it could be power sector building, we're rebuilding actually power sectors and the road sectors, building new bridges and building ports and so on and so forth. There are many such things could happen. And that's a sector that now becoming part and parcel of the new focus area for the US government by allocating huge amount of resources, which essentially means that during the period when these companies went through a challenging period, nobody was spending anything, but these companies have to survive. They have survived during a tough period. Therefore, they underperformed in the market during the tough period. At the same time, the fortune changes by way of huge spending coming in from the government. Then naturally, they tend to perform better. Again, if you look at the chart clearly, you'll see this fluctuation. But we believe that the sector has got a relevance, a bigger play to play. But only thing one has to catch the cycle. That's why it's called the business cycle. The second, if you look at the next slide, if you look at again the housing as a sector, again go through a cycle. But the housing as a sector, I believe it is actually influenced by consumer behavior. You and me are willing to buy houses because interest is available cheap. Because it is available cheap, all of us go and rush towards buying a price. Definitely, the purchasing power, of course, one side is good, no doubt. Because the purchasing power has gone up, the ability of the real estate company to raise prices is also equally high, right? At the same time, there will be a time but the demand is very good, but the real estate company may not raise the prices for one simple reason. You'll have enough inventory with him. You'll have enough inventory. You'll have more land to build. Therefore, it has its own issues. On the basis of this, if you look at housing finance sector, also goes through ups and downs, but again, influenced by one, consumer behavior, interest rate cycles. I think the way I think government wants to influence the sectors, one from the point of employment, increase the revenue for the state government in the form of stamp duty, and also provide the demand for the entire sectors, which I think surrounding that. So that's the way it behaves. Just coming to the next few slides, while there are various sectors, goes through ups and downs, which are, I call it as a link to the various economic cycles, influence the market on the basis of these sectors goes through ups and downs. The sector example I gave, they're all of such nature. But also remember the market, there are sectors which I call it as a structurally bullish or maybe structurally sound businesses do not go through ups and downs, but they go through a dull period versus a bullish period, which is nothing in FMCG. The FMCG company, which is nothing but companies from whom, whose production, say in the case of toothpaste and soaps and detergents and other medicinal things, they're all such companies who are in that space. Generally, the consumer behavior remains intact because of repeated consumptions. They all become day-to-day consumptions. Those sectors generally go through a flat upcycle, long-term upcycles. I call it generally structurally bullish sectors. Second, of course, the next one, if you see, the other sectors, which again, consumer durable sectors, which nothing but you and me buying fridge and TV and mixes and other things. These are the kind of consumers, as your middle-class population keeps growing, more and more people move away from a nuclear family to independent houses. The natural spending on household items remains very, very high. That's why the consumer durable sector generally tend to see not a cyclical nature, but they have the structurally longer term nature in terms of growth. The same way cement as a sector is, given the fact that I took an example for one simple reason, everyone in the country refurbished their house in some form or other. Therefore, the demand for cement, not just related directly to the housing sector, it also linked to the rural development that happens. The government building, various infrastructure, all of them have got a greater influence. And this spending generally remains regular in nature. Therefore, this sector also goes through not so much of volatility as I talked about other things. Just to conclude on the basis of this, and then I'll take any questions that you may have. Clearly, the market goes through cycles for various reasons that are influencing factors in the market. As I mentioned earlier, therefore, the money manager's point of view, when from an industry point of view, even from our own fund that we have just launched, our business cycle fund, clearly, I think is more with that intention of looking at various cycles that are in the market and how do you capture them in the portfolios in order to generate return. While, of course, the money manager will keep doing that, yet what I say, it looks it may look very simple, but as you go deeper, as you start tracking it, as you start reacting, and that's the time I think money manager will continue to keep these influencing factors and take those inputs while taking decision on portfolio constructions. While doing that, from your point of view as an investor, I think you ought to just look at the slides which I showed you. Market will go through ups and downs, it'll form a new high, it'll form a new low, but at the end of the day, every 3 years, it forms a higher, a new high and higher bottom. The next 3 years, it forms a higher bottom, again form a new high. That's the way the market behaves historically. Therefore, from you as an investor, keep goal in mind. And industry, as Neeraj mentioned about, the industry, which is the mutual fund industry, remains now becoming more powerful. And it, I think, is industry which actually caters to the varying needs of the customers and investors. Therefore, keep that confidence in mind. Well, of course, understanding the market behavior, which of course more for knowledge point of view, but leave the job of managing such volatility to the money managers who actually would manage your money and may not be 100% perfect. But even if I do 90% perfect, believe me, the outcome is more or less predictable and satisfactory. I think I'll stop here and over to Neeraj.
Yes, so we have got a few questions from participants, and I'm sure that was a lovely discussion that we have. We saw the sectors in expansion, contraction for last so many years. I think that slide was wonderful. So I got a few questions. Parth Shah is asking a question like, is there a direct relationship between business cycles of different countries?
Yeah, there is, of course, in certain sectors, there is a direct relationship, especially US spending on, say, IT and technology platform as a direct correlation of that in the Indian IT companies. And most of the time, we do track Indian companies. Rather, we do track what is the spending that is being announced by, say, Bank of America and US. Or what is the spending that is being announced by, say, JP Morgan and US. These are some of the things. I think the moment we know that allocation towards IT spending increases, then naturally, they've got a direct correlation. Second is currency impact has got, I think, whenever US does well, then naturally, the US currency gets more stronger, which essentially means Indian currency become weaker. If anybody exports from India, does benefit IT. This IT is one I'm saying. Second, of course, the most of the companies in US, on the base of the supply-demand gap that exists, and then suddenly you'll see the price increase that happens, and there is no supply. Therefore, it actually the tide turn towards the other countries such as India. And that's the time if you see pharma as a sector has got a huge correlation on the base of the outsourcing that happens from US. And China is one country has got a direct correlation on metal as a sector. If they spend a lot of money on the infrastructure building, definitely greater predictability on metal as a sector. At the same time, also we should remember, if China start producing more, then naturally we have to see if they are not able to consume within their own country. And naturally, it comes to outside the country. Therefore, the supply will come, and that puts the price pressure also. This is the way the correlation happens in some many other sectors. And I always believe, again, we normally used to joke in the market when I used to be a trader, if Japan sneezes, India will get cold. The reason why we used to say this, money has become fungible between various countries. And today, it doesn't matter to me, India will stand apart if US falls. It doesn't, because there is a correlation which exists. And that's something which I think seems to have got what do you call, established in every sectors.
Great. So next question is from Melinda Nachane. Melin. He said, I wish to remain a low risk profile investor. Then which sector should I invest?
I think the low risk itself tells you, go to my last few slides, right? The last slides which I had mentioned, like FMCG sectors. It is a sector where you and me can keep on consuming, but they don't increase the prices very marginally. But your consumption, my consumption continues to be on the rise. But the company do well. But I think you must also remember, these companies will give you return only over a period of, say, 15 years or 10 years or 20 years. They'll give you a good dividend, but they'll remain as a safe sector. So there's one such fund that we run as a fund house, which we call it the Birla MNC Fund. I invest only in multinational companies. When I look at the portfolio, some companies have done very well. Some companies have done very badly also. There are one or two companies done very badly, but good company. So the only question is, do we have wherewithal to hold on to such bad period of such kind of good companies during that tough time? And that's the only area where we need to be careful. A good company, that tough time, am I able to hold on to them? A good company, that good time, again, of course, I'll continue to hold. There's no question on that. Right. So the same way, we run one fund which is called GenNext, which actually focuses only on consumption. I only buy companies which has got 50% of turnover coming from you and me as a direct buyer. See, like for example, Hero Honda. You and me go to the shop and then buy directly from Hero Honda dealer. So there is a direct customer connect. So that's the way we actually construct the portfolio. Again, it's done very well, but there will be a period, long give you return. Somebody will suddenly come and tell me, Bala, your fund is not performing well. But I always tell them, just look at the concept of the fund and the base of it, make this judgment. And for you also as an investor, keep this in mind while choosing such kind of thing as a conservative investor.
Great, sir. Next question is from Mr. Hemant. He's asking, sir, how can I predict which sector is going to grow in next 10 years? Or more like IT is booming now. So is it going to keep on growing for next 10 years or more? That's what Hemant.
Interestingly, Hemant, we look at, see, sometimes what happens, a sector which is cyclical nature could become structurally high growth in nature. The reason I'm saying this is, I think IT is an example if you take, these used to be cyclical sectors when it started. As time progress, when technology spending has become the way of life, automation becomes way of life, digital has become the way of life, then naturally the narrative gets changed from a cyclical to the structural. And that, I think, applies for every sector. Therefore, I think for you and me to assess or maybe judge whether it's a 10 years bull cycle market or not bull cycle market, that depends upon how each of the sectors actually positioned at each point of time. And there is absolutely no necessary that cyclical sector will not become a structurally high growth sector, or a structurally high growth sector suddenly will become cyclical sectors because of the change in the environment and so on and so forth. For example, since the time the ESG as a concept came, which is the environment, social governance basis, you start selecting companies. There are many companies, very good companies, generating high cash flow, have become bad because they are not compliant with the ESG. So this is the way I think someone has to just keep this in mind.
Great, sir. Akshit is asking one question, like on power sector, like what is your view? And right from wire makers, cable makers to, you know, renewable powers and all, what do you think? How do you view the power sector?
See, power sector is utility. See, one is a sensitive sector, first of all. So those are like power is like power and telecom. It is a must for you and me. As a consumer, it is a much needed. But unfortunately, there is no pricing power, which is the last common man. There's no price. Suddenly, you can't increase the tariff of the power just because my input cost has gone up. So that burden is taken by the government, not just here, worldwide it happens. Therefore, that's something one has to just keep in mind. Generally, it's a business which is a free cash flow business. And generally, it has got a lower ROE, generally a return on equity or return on investment on such kind of companies. Generally, ranges between 12 to 14%. A company which is an ROE of 12-14%, which essentially means they don't have too much of pricing power, they don't make too much profit, but they remain relevant to the system. So to the extent power as a sectors would be average performer kind of sectors.
Great. Shravan wanted to know about a concept like or terms like secular tailwind. Or can you please explain quickly what?
So I think secular tailwind is like, for example, today is happening in the digital technology side, right? See, let us take the e-commerce platform. So now I think the entire tailwind is more in favor of the making this as a sector to become a secular sector. And I know for sure they're not making money, but definitely the sector, I think he has got a huge relevance because of the change in the consumer behavior and the way I think this platform as a whole, I think is changing. Therefore the whole, the secular nature of this could also potentially become the way forward as we move. That's the way it happens. It happens in every now and then. That's the way I would define that the tailwind is more in favor of some of the sectors, which is the way I would explain.
Okay. So next question is, do social indicators like poverty line impact business cycle? If yes, to what extent? That is a question from Bipin.
What is the question, Niraj? Can you repeat?
Do social indicators like poverty line impact business cycle? Or if yes, to what extent?
See, I think poverty is actually reduces the consumption, right? It reduces the consumption. And I think more the poverty, it also increases the, I think generally keep the tax rates high and ability to spend gets reduced. Therefore, it has a huge impact, especially the way you used to see is, I think if you look at the urban income versus rural income, urban income has got again two types. Urban income above, below poverty line, above poverty line. Rural income, generally the income levels are low. And again, within that below poverty line, then actually if the more number of people in that space clearly has a huge impact on the economic growth because the aspiration will be low, therefore the spending power will be less. Therefore, that will also have an impact on many companies benefiting out of that large population that exists. And in fact, the government of India's initiative of Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas, the way I think they have ensured that the government, the social benefits go to the large pool of people in the country. And the way I think digital technology is now reaching every nook and corner of the country. All such things, in my own belief, is will have huge positive impact on the reduction of poverty. I think, in fact, I think India poverty rates have been reducing. We don't talk about it. And clearly, the poverty rates are coming down. And that's something I would give full credit to our Prime Minister Narendra Modi on this. The last few years, the social benefits have been reaching the real beneficiaries. That, in fact, have made them self-sufficient. I will not say they have made them richer. So I will not tell them they have made them richer. They have become self-sufficient. Now, they don't have to beg. They don't need to go and take somebody else's help. And that's something has happened. Therefore, it will have a very high positive impact. The social benefit will have a huge positive impact on the spending behavior of the consumers.
Great. So next to that IT sector, another question, related question about IT sector. Utsav wants to know, like, what are the major risks in IT sector?
See, I think the risk is about the expenditure, right? It's about how companies have got two, three things. One, how companies are able to adapt to the new way of building or maybe supporting various needs of growing needs of companies, right? In the sense, somebody has been an application software provider and moving from the actually to provide digital related technology platform, artificial intelligence based analytical platform, the data analytical platforms, how companies migrate by keeping up the learning curve. Even for companies or old companies, keeping up the learning curve is very important. Therefore, how companies are able to keep up the learning curve and therefore they're able to remain relevant, a large player in every segment in which you operate, that's one. Second, of course, is the spending. I think the higher the spending coming from budgeting, right? If you and me have a budget every year, I have to spend so much money on laptop and so on. So every 3-4 years, I change it. And I suddenly upgrade my software and so on and so forth after running a company. Therefore, how much is the allocation that we keep? And third, of course, is the currency. Many times, since the IT companies have got a direct impact, especially for Indian companies or maybe companies outside the US dollar, most of the companies get the revenue either in US dollar or in euro. And the US dollar and euro many times can go through fluctuations. And therefore, they'll also have some kind of impact on the company's earnings. And finally, is the talent pool. I think these companies are driven by people and people and people. Therefore, there used to be a time we used to measure the success of companies on the basis of bench strength. And based on bench strength, on the basis of new recruits, all of them used to be one of the indicators we used to look at. Nowadays, of course, not many talk about it. But clearly, these are some of the things are the influencing factor to measure the aspiration of the companies or preparation of the companies for the future. So TCS, if it recruits, say, 20,000 people in a year, that means he has the people who are trying to go and the new people come in and then go and then employee force rising. But the business keeps rising, that naturally means has a positive impact. So these are some of the measurements, simple measurement metrics. I think one can keep it as part of the tracking systems.
So your views on electric vehicle sector, electric vehicles and defense sector. I think this is a question from Ishan and Max Payne Kumar.
Yeah. Thanks, Ishan. Of course, EV is something I think is going to, the way I look at it, every country today now start declaring they want to become a carbon emission free. And that first and declare, even India has given 2070, they are given, if I'm not wrong. They want to become a carbon emission free because they know very well that in India, we need to do a lot of groundwork we have to cover up.
Right.
And I think now will become the order of the day. The question is, I think we have to only measure the population of electric vehicles vis-a-vis the conventional vehicles. how the ratio is. Assuming scenario today is 1 lakh versus 1, and then 1 lakh versus, it'll become 10, then 1 lakh versus 20, 1 lakh versus 100. I think that's the roadmap in which you'll go. I would assume eventually the world will move towards 50 to 60% of the vehicles will be in the EV and hybrid vehicles, and balance will be in the conventional vehicles. So if that population rises, naturally EV as a business, I think, will become a high focus area. And India, of course, definitely the big push will come. The next government, when they come back to power in 2024, probably they'll give a big push for EV progress. In the same way, defense is something is more internal. I think defense is something, I think often I've heard from Prime Minister, and even during the budget time, we used to hear the defense spending is more encouraging companies to produce in India. Why do you want to implicate? Defense is one of the bigger import that we have. I think India does not produce the high-end defense equipment or maybe highly efficient defense equipment in India, unlike what happens in Russia and other friends, France and other global market. That's something definitely India is actually increasing their focus. Therefore, defense sectors would also get benefit out of a huge amount of spending that now being made as a local for local consumption and also local for global, right? Both of them are, the Prime Minister is focusing on that. I think defense is one sector is also being part of that.
Okay, great, sir. I think we'll take one or two more questions. Ravi Joshi is asking, like, which sector, in your opinion, have high pricing power and yet stable?
See, the sector has got high pricing power. I would say, I think pharma as a sector has got a reasonably high pricing, except the government definitely controls the price. And hospital sectors have got a high pricing power, but it remain stable. And the cement as a sector has got a high pricing power, but it remains still stable. And again, depending upon which segment in which you operate, like FMCG company have got a pricing power, but they don't price it because it directly hits the consumers. They don't increase it, at the same time, they also don't reduce it. They keep it reasonably good margin business. And high pricing power is there because they're all consumption of such goods, such consumables are very high. They have a reasonably good pricing power. Whereas there are certain sectors that don't have high pricing power. So they have a pricing power, but for various reasons, they don't focus on pricing because of competitive pressure. I'm not talking about telecom as industry. It's you may know very well that I don't mind paying if somebody increase the tariff on the mobile messages and so on and so forth. But because of the competitive pressure, such companies also do not have the luxury of increasing the prices. They have a pricing power, but the question, do they have the luxury to increase the prices?
I think that's it, sir. You have taken lots of questions and lots of questions are coming. And I'm sure two sessions tomorrow are going to answer a lot many questions. But I think it's a wonderful, wonderful session, sir. We have really understood, participants have really understood, get a good in-depth understanding about different sectors and the sector rotations and which is going to perform in different phases of the economy, sir. I would like to really appreciate for your time. And so your last advice to our participant about sector rotation, about the investments.
Thanks, Niraj, and thanks for having me part of your show.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So guys, I'm going to declare now the winners of the two rounds that we had. That's great that lot many participants, so lots of you have participants. So let me announce the winners of the round one. The winners of the round one are round two. Round one is Mr. Ashutosh Gupta, Mr. Mudit Sharma, Sairam Annamenai, okay, Sushman Dev, and Tarbez Pasha. So congratulations to all the winners of the round one. And the winners of the second round are Ravi Joshi, Sanket Mohanty, Sumit Chetty, Supritam Sirkar and Vishesh Tyagi. So congratulations to all the winners and thank you all for participating in this quiz contest. So guys, that's the end today and looking forward to see you all tomorrow. We have got very powerful speakers line up and we have got very interesting topics that's coming up. So guys, see you tomorrow morning. So long for today. Have a great evening. Thank you so much. Bye-bye. And okay, once more, don't forget to give your feedback before you leave on the session.